safest systems in the world, probably the safest aviation system in the entire world. But the margin of safety has diminished.
What's being done to prevent deadly crashes like this? Could simple safety products like smoke hood save lives if there is a deadly fire? Is the flying public safe enough from fire? Find out on Why Planes Burn. More than 17,000 flights land and take off daily without incident in this country. Flying has become so affordable, so commonplace, that 415 million of us flew last year alone. Most of us never think about what we might do if a fire were to break out on board. A fire that would be fast-moving, terrifying, and deadly. There would be panic and hysteria as people struggled to escape. Most of us have no idea how we'd get out or how desperately little time we'd have to do it. In this simulated fire, the volunteers had only a realistic 90 seconds to escape. Those who took longer were considered dead. Accidents in aircraft are very rare. When they do happen, more than 80% are survivable accidents, when the impact itself isn't severe enough to kill people. But over the years, many people have died in survivable accidents, and most of them died from smoke and fire. Paris, France, 1973. This 707 landed only 8 minutes after a fire broke out in a lavatory. 124 passengers and crew died from the smoke and fumes. Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, 1980. This L-1011 made an emergency landing with a fire on board. All 301 people, including the captain and crew, died before they could escape. Malaga, Spain, 1982. This DC-10 bound for New York with 394 passengers caught fire when it crashed on takeoff. Flames swept through the crowded fuselage. 50 people died. Manchester, England, 1985. This 737 abandoned takeoff after the captain heard an explosion. The plane, ablaze with burning fuel, continued down the runway. People in the terminal watched helplessly as the crippled aircraft was engulfed in flames. Many people did escape somehow, but 55 died in a plane that never left the ground. Roy Metcalf was a passenger on that plane.
The flames came through the windows and up onto the ceiling, and all the ceiling started to burn. And then it rapidly spread. It was the heat of the cabin. It was so hot that you could feel your flesh creeping like that. And I think myself that it was the seats, the foam had reached the flash point, and they just went up. And the thick black smoke came down, and that's all there was to breathe. And when it got to the top of the aircraft, which was burning, and there were tongues of flames going along the fuselage of the aircraft, this stuff came down like rain. And your ears were filled, your nose was packed out like a gorilla, and your eyes were all full of this filth from the seats. People were on fire. I saw one lady who had just had her hair done, and it must have been very heavily lacquered, because all of a sudden, and her hair went, the lock went, it just reached its flash point, and she, in a panic, ran the wrong way. Well, some people came over the backs of the seats because the aisles were absolutely jammed full of people. And I got into the aisle and went with the crowd. Just went with the crowd, which was very, very slow indeed. I couldn't see a thing. I knew I was in row 9, and I had the presence of mind to put my right hand out and count the seats as I went down. And I got to about row 4 and put my hand on somebody's head and knocked the glasses off. And I thought, well, he or she is a goner. And then I got a little further on, and my left foot got caught under somebody's armpit that was on the floor, because there were bodies, seemed to be bodies all over, or in someone's crutch. And that foot was captive with the weight of the people behind me. And I fell then, I think, into row 2. I was choking. This acrid cyanide smoke, two whiffs and I'm quite sure he'd have had it. I fell into row two, and I felt this drifting, floating sensation. There was no sense, there was no sight, obviously. There was no, and just before this, the flames were roaring. There was no sense of hearing, no sense of smell, no sense of taste, and no sense of touch. You seemed just to be suspended for, it seemed about a week. And then I heard a voice saying, "Roy, get onto the floor, the air will be clearer." And I realized that it was my own voice and that I actually was on the floor. And I always keep a hanky in my top shirt pocket. And I picked the hanky out to try and breathe through it. But my mouth was full of this filth from the seats, and I put my finger in my mouth and brought it out like crumbled Oxo cubes. That was all there was to breathe. And then I'd lost my glasses, and I got the hanky and opened my right eye and pulled the handkerchief across my eyeball to get rid of this muck. And by doing that, I saw a little light as big as a postage stamp towards the bottom left. And I made a beeline for it. I've been asked before, did I crawl, did I walk, did I run? I don't know. I'd gone down the chute head first, apparently, through about 4 foot of foam. And as I looked up the chute, I saw the whole top of the aircraft just dissolve like a little piece of house foil. And there was this tremendous bang, which I must have passed out by then. And the next thing I knew, I was being swabbed down in hospital.
Investigation of the Manchester accident began at once. An engine overdue for maintenance had exploded, igniting thousands of gallons of fuel. Flames melted the windows and entered the cabin even before the plane came to a stop. Evacuation was delayed by panic, confusion, and emergency doors that wouldn't open. 46 of the victims were killed by smoke and toxic gas. The $20 million plane was destroyed. Britain's aviation authorities have corrected the design problem that led to the devastation here. This particular combination of events may never happen again. But why did it happen at all? Are current standards of air fire safety as stringent as technology permits? What regulations protect the flying public? Who makes the regulations and who enforces them? In the United States, two government agencies are involved. One is the National Transportation Safety Board.
The Safety Board investigates aviation accidents to determine the probable cause of the accident and to determine as well why the people are killed and injured, and then to make recommendations to, number one, prevent the accident from reoccurring, and secondly, to prevent needless deaths and injury in the future.
Because it is first on the scene of an accident, the Safety Board usually has a very clear picture of what went wrong. After each investigation, it recommends changes to ineffective or obsolete safety regulations. But despite its familiarity with the grim reality of airline accidents, the Safety Board can only recommend changes, not require them. That's the job of the Federal Aviation Administration, which creates and enforces all the regulations that affect air travel in this country. The FAA also conducts its own fire prevention and protection research.
We actually have, in cooperation with industry, an extensive research and development program. Typically, we spend somewhere between $5 and $20 million a year, depending on the year and the projects underway, in research programs designed to understand better how to survive in the event of an accident that involves fire.
The most deadly threat in an aviation accident comes from fuel. Thousands of gallons of kerosene are carried in huge tanks in the wings and fuselage. If those vulnerable tanks rupture, as they easily do in an accident, the spilling fuel can erupt in a spectacular fireball. In the 1940s, researchers used red-colored water in the tanks to discover why liquid fuel was so dangerously explosive. When the fuel tanks rupture, the spilling liquid trails behind. Then it sprays forward in a mist of tiny droplets that would be highly volatile if this were fuel. In lab tests, they saw how liquid kerosene mists and ignites almost instantly when it's propelled over a flame. But when they blended the kerosene with additives to form a kind of gel, it didn't ignite at all.